yelele, oh yelele, oh yelele, mama we. Yelele, mama we, yelele, mama we, oh oh.
I'm really honored and pleased to introduce Rodrigo Cala as our keynote today. He was born in Mexico City on a small family farm and moved to Minnesota in 2004. In 2005, Rodrigo joined the Minnesota Food Association, where he successfully completed the Big River Farms Immigrant and Minority Farmer Training Program, organic farming training, and GAP training. Over the course of 3 years, in 2008, Rodrigo and his brother Juan Carlos purchased their farm, Cala Farms, Cala Farm Orianes, located in Turtle Lake, Wisconsin. They currently sell certified organic produce to various accounts in the Twin Cities, and he also works as a trainer for Latino Economic Development Center, which is a locally based nonprofit focused on creating economic opportunities for Latinos. Welcome, Rodrigo.
Thanks. Hi, everyone. Good morning. I'm gonna apologize for my English. I say all the time. I don't born in this country, so sometimes my English or my language is funny. So I'm gonna apologize for that. But I'm gonna try to explain about my history, about my work, about the people who believe on me. So I have a PowerPoint. I finished last night. So I don't know. Maybe it's good, maybe it's not, but I try my best. So okay. My name is Rodrigo Cala. I'm gonna explain about myself. The first thing, I am a farmer. It's my passion. And I have a few roles with, sounds like really, really big, but I don't know. I do that. I don't know how, but I do that. So I am a co-owner of Cala Farm with my brother, Carlos. I'm gonna show you some pictures of him, so you know him. I am a co-director of Shareground, marketing co-op to sell our produce. I am a farm trainer with a Latino Economic Development Center. I am a businessman. I am an accountant. I don't have a title for be an accountant, but I am an accountant for my farm. So I have the title. I am a tractor driver. It's not because I really love to be a tractor driver, but I need to do that. Sometimes when there's nobody to gonna drive the truck to the cities, I need to do that too. Most of the time I do that. So I am a farm worker. I am the face of Cala Farm. I am the quality control person on my farm. So I really, really focus on the quality of the produce and I deliver it to the cities. I am a father, I am a son, I am brother, I am friend. And besides all these things I do, if I have time, I drink a beer, so I can be an alcoholic too. So I am a regular person, nothing fancy. Okay. So this is me. So I have the proofs so I am a farmer. So this is my kids. This picture is a few years ago, I take from Mexico, but I these are my kids. It's Rodrigo, Brian, and Alex. And I have my daughter, but I don't have a picture of her. So, but yeah, we are farmers. So, who is Cala Farm? It's a farm business, and it's owned by my brother and I. It's a crazy team because most of the time we fire because it's the way how the brothers are. We fight for everything. Every decision, we have some issues. So we are from Mexico City. It's funny, but in Mexico City, we have farms. It's no matter how big is the city, we still have some small farms in the middle of the city. My brother, he immigrated in 2000. I immigrated in 2004. So he's my brother. This is me. So we're working on the farm. We're working a lot. Oh my God. I can say I work an insane amount of hours on the field. Just on my farm, plus in another farms. Okay, I'm gonna explain from the beginning. When I arrived to this country, I arrived in 2004. I working for 10 years on a factory doing horseshoes. But at the same time, I working this factory job, plus I working on the farm. I start really, really small. So the first steps when I arrived to this country, was funny because I tried to buy a house and I going to the bank and I say, I wanna buy a house. And they told me, okay, do you have credit? And I say, well, what's that? So the first thing I learned is if you don't have credit on this country, you don't exist. So what's the first thing what I start doing? So how I build my credit is the first thing what I buy was a computer, a $300 computer, but they explained me the system. So the first thing what I get with my credit was my computer. The second thing was a tiller. The third thing was a tractor. The fourth thing was a greenhouse. The fifth thing was another tractor. I don't know how many times I back and forth for my credit to the last thing I get is my farm on 2008. So I'm gonna explain step by step. So I work with different organizations in this country. I get trainings from A to C. So on the first organization what I work with was with ANIDA. It's an organization based on the East Side on St. Paul. They teach me about taxes, about the home stretch when you try to buy a house. The finances, that is very important. When you try to build a business, you need to start seeing how good you are with money or how bad you are with money. So you can start fixing all the problems from the beginning. The rights, obligations. If you see, I start this on 2005. I start working 1 year, and the next year, because I need to make my taxes, I start seeing, okay, I need to go into these steps. So on 2007, I start working with Latino Economic Development Center. getting some trainings for business plans, for record keepings, like QuickBooks, and small business trainings for my farm. At the same time, I take trainings on Minnesota Food Association, and I finished my training in 2008. The same, as soon as I finish my training, I get my farm in 2008. And when I was in Mexico, I grew produce on conventional base. So when I arrived to Minnesota, I start working on to understand all the organic farming. And when they explain me what's about organic farming, I feel really engaged with that, with all the terms and rules and regulations. So, and I have another feeling. I start growing organic food because I want to make really good food for my family, and then I want to make money. I can talk about how romantic it is to be working on the farm, but that is not true. We really like to make money. We need to make money as the way to empower ourselves, the way to make money. And I am, sometimes when I talk with people like agroecologist people, and I explain my terms, I don't know, I think they don't like, but this is the way how we can continue doing this job, making money. Otherwise, like we don't work on farms because we want to be tired to go to sleep. We don't do that. So okay. In 2008, I learned between 2005 and 2008, I learned the way what is the difference between organic versus conventional. So I transfer all my knowledge to organic productions. On 2007, I start working with the USDA in some trainings. I have a really close relationship with people of who do the inspections. Was really hard because at that time, when I start working with them, my English was really, really weak. So they was very patient with me. So they teach me many, many different ways to pass my audits. The organic certifications with the agencies, I work really, really close to them. Even right now, I'm working with them to helping other farmers to do that. And other thing, what I learned with the USDA is the tractor safety. We're thinking when people say, oh, the tractor is really, really slow, a slow car or something. But no, the tractor are really, 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 really dangerous. If you don't think really, really deep on how much safety you need to be, when you're driving a tractor, you can kill yourself. And it is an issue. It's really, really big. So now I can turn to Cala Farm. So on 2008, we get a 46 hectares farm, 26 acres are forest, 17 acres are open land, and we grow produce on 11 acres. We have farm buildings, we are certified organic since 2008. We do a four years crop rotation at 1 or 2 years soil building. This is my farm. I can't believe I get a farm. Oh my God. But this is the first year when we get the certification for this small part. I think it's like 2 or 3 acres. 36 months later, we certify all the farm. We have a house. We have greenhouses. We have a few more really old buildings, but some we fixing, some we throw away. So we working really hard. This is my brother, my daughter. I have my daughter there in the middle of my brother and I. This is myself growing cucumbers. My markets, 40% of my markets is on wholesale, 40% is on CSA, and 20% is some kind of wholesale and retail. We sold to restaurants. When I talk with new farmers, I explain them, you never grow cheap food. Try to make as more money from your produce as you can. This is just a simple rule. Don't grow produce like the companies pay you on cents. So I'm gonna explain you why. Okay, this is some of my customers. I started working with Chipotle in 2006. They offered me a contract for $25 a case, but I think was an strategic just for them for sell more burritos and carnitas to sell more, because as soon as passed that promotion, the price of the peppers was down and down and down. And on 2013, they told me, oh, we can pay you $11 a case. So it's organic peppers, $11 a case. And the value of just the case is $2. So they pay $9 for my peppers. So I say, nope. And I don't feel really bad. I don't feel bad. I feel, no, I don't want to work for free. So it's, when you do your record keeping and your QuickBooks and you understand your business, you take all these kind of decisions really easily. You say, I make money on this, okay, I'm gonna do this. I don't make money, I don't do this. It's simple. So I work with Big River Farm. I start working with them on selling products on 2007. The first 2 years I start growing some crops, but not really. On 2007, I start selling some produce to Rick River Farm. Last year, I don't sell any produce to them because I don't know why, but I start selling produce to co-partners. I start working with them on 2010. I start selling to them broccoli. It's my main crop. Most of my income I make on broccoli, and the broccoli opened the key for another markets with different companies. So I start with co-partners, I start with broccoli, then I start selling garlic, tomatoes, bell peppers. And if I have extra produce of, I think, cauliflowers or cabbage, I give a call to them and I say, I have 20 more cases, I have 50 more cases. And because the relationship, they help me. We own share ground. Later, I'm gonna explain you what is share ground. But on share ground, I sold a broccoli, bell peppers, tomatoes, garlic, leeks, cabbage, cauliflowers, onions. I don't grow many crops. Later, I'm gonna explain you why. On 2016, I start working with the quiche. So I start with broccoli. So I talk with them already of selling. We're gonna try to sell a few more crops, but it's the beginning. If you see broccoli, it's my champ. And I don't want to say this, but we are the best growing broccoli. If you see, sometimes when I go into meetings with the buyers, the people, oh, you are from Cala Farm. Yep, okay. We really want to buy your broccoli. And I don't want to offend the other farmers because it's really, when I say this, people want to kill me, but it's true. So this is my crops. I have just, okay. I grow broccoli, bell peppers, garlic, tomatoes, onions, cabbage, cauliflowers, leeks, and we grow transplants for other farmers. And our main crop are four: is broccoli, bell peppers, garlic, and heirloom tomatoes. And the other crops we grow because the people ask to grow that. But I don't really like to grow that many crops. On the future, I think I'm gonna focus just on two or three crops. I'm gonna talk about my role on LEDC. I start working with them, getting trainings and learning. I start working with them on a small business training, developing my business plan, record keeping. And I think it's now, because I teach in people, it's a really big issue for farmers. They don't like to take records. It's a big issue because the records can help you to take really good decisions, like what I made when I see how much money the Chipotle, the big chain of food, they want to pay for my peppers. If I don't have the credit of the records at the time, I can't take the decision. So now I encourage the new farmers to do records as best as they can. So in 2010, LEDC, they gave me the opportunity to work with them. So if you can see, I work in there with Hafa Farm, giving training to them. And for me, at the first time when I tried to talk with Hmong, they don't allow me to tell them like, oh, it's another way to do farming. So I think right now they are more open with me. I think they are more confident on me. So sometimes when I go into half a farm or another monk farmer, they are more open with me. I think, oh, this guy is a nice guy. So right now I have the relation with them too. I'm gonna explain a little bit about LEDC. Besides farming trainings, they help, not me, I working on the agricultural team, but it's more people working there, but they give opportunities to people who want to open a business. I really like the mission and the idea to empower our people. When we're talking with the communities about healthy food access, the people they thinking is not big, but at this moment, because of these diseases and illness, is really an issue, because the food is medicine. If you really have a really good diet, you can have a different life. And another thing LEDC works is working on co-ops, developing a small business on a group of people, and they helping farmers with loans too. So I can say this is part of my work. I give trainings to the farmers on organic techniques. I help them to farm planning, all the techniques what we use on an organic basis. I teach them to they can ride a tractor, how they can use a transplanter, how they can run a small greenhouse operation. And the important, most, I think one of the most important parts of these trainings is step-by-step certifications. That made really, really difference, and it's very important for our community. So when you see this logo, I really compromise myself and my business and the people who I work with and try to get these stickers on your produce. You can not just can get more money, you can get more recognition with people. So I'm gonna show some pictures. I have a farm. Agua Gorda is a farm in Long Prairie, Minnesota. If you see, I am on the middle. Try to help in them to pass the inspection. So on the beginning, I thinking LEDC give me the opportunity to work with them porque hablo español, but no, it's not true. I am a really very good farmer. I'm sorry for say that. So I have a farm in Agua Gorda and Long Prairie. I think it's Wasika. This is in Austin, Minnesota. This is in Wilmar, working with farmers around the state. I working with farmers around a few years ago, just on the state. Right now I'm working on Wisconsin, on Washington, on Florida. What else? I don't remember where, but many places. Florida. Okay, I'm gonna talk about Share Ground. Share Ground is a marketing co-op owned by farmers. It's owned by two Anglo farms plus three Latino farms. If you see this logo, it's me. Remember on us. So we started this project in 2014. This business is owned by, I tell you, two Anglo farms. One Anglo farm is based on Minneapolis, and it's an urban farm. The other farm, Whetstone, is in Emory, Wisconsin. The focus is on meat, grass-fed lamb and grass-fed pork. Cala Farm, you see a little bit of my history. La Familia is in Wasika. They focus on salad mix. Agua Gorda, who is in Long Prairie, Minnesota, they grow 40. They sold 50,000 pounds of tomatillos and jalapenos to make tamales on the Twin Cities for a company called La Loma based on Minneapolis. And we start getting produce for 28 more farms. The biggest challenge is find more markets. It's no matter how good or how bad farmer you are. If you are no enough markets, you are done. It's no matter if you say, oh, in my farm we can grow the best tomatoes in the world. But if you don't have where you can sell, that's it. You can see your produce lie on the field and it's really sad. But it's the truth. So when I start working with new farmers, new immigrants, I explain them, instead to try to think in big on your farm, just focus on the markets first. Try to really start really, really small. When I work on the communities with the new farmers, some people really make fun of us because we really start really, really small with small plots on the city plots. Garden city plots, really, really small, and then after a few years, they can see how the farms, they can grow. So the big challenges when I working with all these farmers is social justice. Try to get land and infrastructure, loans, and credit. If you don't have access to capital, it's really, really hard. Try to build a business. Insurance, licenses, certifications, even try to make a farmer to thinking he's a business person is really a challenging. most of the people, they thinking, oh, I don't have the skills. And you can see myself. When I arrived to this country, I don't have any of these skills. I learned to use a computer. I learned to use big tractors. I learned to use, speak English. It's not that good, but I try. So the way to change our community, and I don't speak just in besides of Latino community, I speak really loud about the immigrant community. The average age of Latinos on this country is 58. So I have a big question for the new, I have the question for everybody, like who's gonna be the next generation of farmers in this country? And I, like immigrant, I say, we need to take this opportunity for us. We need to think in from now to 20 years, who's gonna be the next generation to farmers in this country? And we need to take this chance. So when I talking about social justice, I know I don't really like to see, oh, we wanna fire with a big corporation. I don't like to say that. I really like to see our people, empower our people, getting better education, get more money, get more, get better jobs. And I think if you see yourself like a farm worker all the time, no, you can be the owner of these farms. And it's really sad for me when I going to visit really dairy, big dairy farms to the workers on the on that farms are Latinos, and I see, oh, who is the owner of this company? Oh, he don't live here. He comes every 2 or 3 months to see who is the business. So I, for myself, I say, we are not just hard workers. We can do this. We can own these businesses. So when I speak to people, I say, see myself. If I can do, you can do too. So, I'm gonna talk about Sharon. This is some pictures of voice or meetings. You can see, I don't wanna say this word, but you can see whites and browns try to do something together. At this time, it's really hard to talk about colors. I don't like that, but it's what it is. You can see. Right there, is we meeting. Sometimes we meeting. We have meetings in schools. We have meetings on houses, on the barns, on bars. So in the places where we can allow us to be for a few hours and drinking some drinking and eating, we do our meetings. What did this succeed for us is we have access to new markets. We developing a multicultural business, and it's really, really a big issue. We have more access to loans. We have a really positive impact on the community. Cooperation is really hard. It's hard one. We can have a really good mission, and we can talk and talk, but if we don't have the ability to work together, we are done. Like small farms, small businesses, is the only way to compete with the huge corporations. If we don't work together, we are done. Trainings, the way how we can work together, we're going to speak with people, with the University of Minnesota, say, okay, we need trainings on soil, we need trainings on food safety, because we are 10 or 20 people on a class, they say, okay, we can do that. So remember this, we are not just a hard workers. Like immigrants, we can own businesses. This is some examples of what we can do together. It's a company based on St. Paul. I don't know, maybe everybody remembers them. Linders, they grow plants and flowers. They close down, and we get all the greenhouses from them. We get not all the greenhouses, but some. We get 15 greenhouses. With all the farmers, with a group of farmers, we take it down. Take for us a year to take it down. We try to put it up now. It's gonna take maybe another 2 years. But this is the way how we can do this is because we're working together on trainings, working on the field. I learned a lot going to different farms. And I bring all this knowledge and advice to new farmers. In the past, we tried to do everything by hand, but some of the farms you can see from zero to really, really big operations. You can see, I need to buy a tractor, but I don't have a trailer. So we find somebody, help us to get our tools on our farms. Questions? Thank you. Thank you very much. She asked about where I can give the trainings. If you have enough farmers, I can go to your farm too. I don't give the training to just for one or two farmers. If you find like 10, at least 10 farmers, I can go to another state. I need to speak with my boss, but most of the time I am really positive. On this business, I am really, really positive. So when people approach me and ask me, can you help us on Wisconsin or on Washington? My first reaction is yes, but I want to ask first. But yeah, if you have enough people, we can go to your property, to your farm. The plastic mulch, how long we can keep? We can keep for a season. On organic production, you just keep the plastic for one season. So as soon you finish, you need to take it out. Yep. You can keep the plastic for next year, but for organic productions, you need to take it out. Because the soil need to have the cycle. So every year you need to move your crops to another part of the farm. What are you doing on winter time? On wholesale? Okay, if I'm doing something for wholesale on winter time, no. On winter time, most of my time I use teaching classes with other farmers. Who I work on my farm, I try to. Is why we try to putting more greenhouses because we try to extend it. Thank you. Yeah, sometimes it's really hard for me to say some words because I don't use to speak it that much English, that much English. Sometimes most of the time I speak Spanish. So for have an extension, we try to put greenhouses on the farm. It's the only way to try to extend the season. Otherwise, if you're thinking, I hear that so many times, like, I am the best farmer in the world. Yes, but you're going to deal with the weather. And the weather is more powerful than us. So. Yes, we are certified organic since 2008. Right now, all the farm is organic, certified.
Looking at the picture, they're really good.
We use some, it's not chemicals, it's like repellents or biological insecticides. It's different things you can use, but it's, okay, organic farming is not just you don't apply pesticides. Organic farming is totally different. It's a big system. You need to work with cover crops. You need to work with crop rotation. You need to work with what else? What else, Wendy? It's many different things you need to work. You need to work at the same time. At the first, sounds really, really complicated, but no, it's really easy. And because you take care of the soil, and that is the base of your operation. If you have a really, really, really good soil, your plants, they're gonna grow really, really strong enough so they can handle some pests. So it's the same when you start building a house. You don't start building a house from the top. You start building a house from the foundation. So the most important part for organic farmers is the soil. It's no matter what people said, it's the soil. If you put your knowledge on the soil, you are on the next level. And I start seeing my farm. I want to show you some pictures. I'm sorry. Yep, you can see the picture of my peppers. Mm-hmm. And we focus on the disease. We really, because we work in there all the time, the plants, they can tell you, because you see, you're going to see something is wrong. You can see really easily. You can see my produce. And this is one point with my produce. The people thinking, oh, this guy is lucky, or the people, I don't know, they really like him. But no, it's because the quality of my produce. You can see my broccoli is what, I don't want to say, but it's the best. And you can see, you can ask the co-ops, you can ask the restaurants. You have broccoli from Cala Farm? Yeah, okay, we want. Otherwise they say, oh, we pass. So you can see my heirloom tomatoes. Take for me 4 years to grow, oh, we have 10 more minutes. Okay, when I start growing heirloom tomatoes, I start planting, wow, almost 2,000 plants of heirloom tomatoes, and I don't make any money. I lose money. I try to find out why I don't have the ability to grow heirloom tomatoes. But the way we don't have the ability to grow tomatoes is because the rain, it's because the water. So when we cover our heirloom tomatoes, right now I put 450 plants on the greenhouses, and I can make more than $10,000. Just on 450 plants. So I can harvest more than 10 pounds on each plant. So take for me like 4 years to understand that. As soon as I understand, I get the greenhouses. The first year when I put a greenhouse, a high tunnel, I made $3,000 the first year when I changed my system. So for the CSA, you can see the picture there. Is the greenhouses there? You can see all the pictures. If I take pictures for next year, you're gonna see a different crops in every plot. I really like my farm. So I'm gonna say something, I forget. Oh, Okay, I remember. Okay, we grow produce for CSA, a community support agriculture. So that means people who want to buy local produce give us their money in advance, and for 18 or 20 weeks we deliver a box full of produce every week. I tried that system for 4 years and I don't make any money. So I don't, it's a real question for me. Try to understand how the people who really focus on CSA, they do that. They make money. They say they make money, but I don't think so. But anyway. But the thing is, as I understand, if one farm is why we work in 5 or 6 farms together, because each farm can grow 4 or 5 crops and in really, really, really good quality. And focus just on 2 or 3 crops, make your farm really, really specialize on these crops, and you can grow really, really, really beautiful produce. I don't believe on a farm grow 20, 40, 50, 60 different crops. It's crazy. And I respect the farmers. You say you can do, okay. But I have my opinion, my personal opinion. I try with numbers. I try with, I don't know, the most I get of CSA was, I think, 35 CSA members, and I don't make any money. I have a lot of frustration. So I say, no, this is not for me. So when I focus on working with other farmers, so each farmer can grow 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 crops, and then bingo. It's the way how you can make more money. I always talk about money, but it's reality. Okay. More questions? Oh. It's what I say in the beginning. Try to work with an organic basis. You need to have a system also, a really big system for your farm. You need to do a crop rotation. You need to work with cover crops to slow down the other weeds. So I start working from 2 years ago with a new system. I have pigs on my farm. So I break the ground with the pigs, but I really working right now with the GAP certification instead of how much time they allow me to have the pigs on the plot. So I don't know for sure how good or how bad is for the soil, but I don't know, maybe next year I can make a class for that. But it's really, you need to find a way. We're using a lot of plastic mulch. And I have some really bad opinions from people who say, oh, we are ecological people. We don't want the contamination of plastic mulch. But I really want to think in on yourself. I mean, I don't like to be 8 hours a day waiting in the field. So it's tools. On the markets they have tools, and when I see tools, I say about the implements, about tractors. I really like to show people, like, okay, see a tractor, not like, oh, this is really expensive. No, it's a tool. See your computer like a tool. See your truck like a tool. It's the way to make your work easier. And I really, it's a word like mechanization is the way to keep doing this job. if you have your kids, like mines, telling, oh, this is a really fun work. You're really gonna love being on the farm all day for 8 hours on the sun? No. They're gonna say, no. I can find a better job. But if you really have tools, if you really have the infrastructure for doing your job better, it's gonna be the key. And I really show my kids that we have a lot of space, we are free to work on the farm. Not every day on the farm is a different day. It's why I choose to work with farmers instead to keep working on a factory. I work on a factory for 10 years, and finally, I feel like I'm gonna do this job for 30 years. So it's a big question for everybody. So, yep. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to be here today. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Mama, we, oh.